This past winter, a young man in San Diego named Francisco Canseco was picked up by the police. They had him for dozens of vandalism violations. Francisco is a serial tagger, a compulsive graffiti artist who doesn't seem to understand the word no. He was in court this past April to answer for these charges. They knew he had done the graffiti because Francisco uses a moniker in his work. Most prolific graffiti taggers have a nickname for themselves. It's kind of like their own little trademark. Whenever they tag a building or a train or a car or a wall, they put their moniker on their work so everybody knows that it was theirs. Francisco had a recognizable moniker on his graffiti. It was too recognizable. Graffiti in San Diego is so bad that police use a computer system to help keep track of all of the different graffiti. And when they catch somebody spraying graffiti on a wall, they compare that person's moniker with other graffiti in their system to help them figure out where that person has been tagging walls. Francisco had his moniker on over 60 graffiti jobs in town. As I said, he made a court appearance in April to answer for those charges. The report didn't say how the court date went for him, besides saying that he was charged with 5 misdemeanors. But as the police kept tracking him, they noticed that his moniker appeared in the last place that you might have expected it to appear. I can't tell you how he did this without being noticed. He's obviously really slick. But apparently Francisco must have been really bored while he was sitting in court waiting for his chance to talk to the judge during his court date in April. Sure enough, police found graffiti in the courtroom itself bearing Francisco's imprint. He tagged the courtroom with graffiti while waiting to enter a plea on charges of spraying graffiti all over the town. I gotta ask you, was the bailiff asleep when this was going on? Granted, Francisco was probably doing it with a marker, but still. And what do you make of somebody who does graffiti in a courtroom while being arraigned for doing graffiti? Does he have impulse control problems? Did anybody ever say the word no to this guy? Now that's kind of an extreme example. And yet all of us have struggled at various times in our lives with saying no to something that we just feel compelled to do. Or saying yes to something that we know we should do, but we can't seem to make ourselves do. But there isn't just a question of self-discipline sometimes. Sometimes we have to deal with the very issue of sin in our lives. It's sinful to destroy our lives with alcohol because we can't say no when we really should. Destroying our families by gambling away our money and our credit just because we can't seem to say no is an issue of sin and justice. It is an issue of sin and justice to destroy our lives and devastate the people we love by being sexually immoral because we can't say no when we need to. And yet, why is it that people of faith find it so easy to overlook those concerns and do the very thing we know we're not going to do? The very thing that we know God hates. The very thing we've promised ourselves we're going to stop. Why do we want those things in the first place? Is there something wrong with us? Or is there something wrong with the world? And is there any place for us here in the church to talk about those things, to be honest, to help each other learn how to say no? Why do we find ourselves concealing those parts of our lives from one another at church? Those questions, which we still deal with today, are at the heart of what Paul was dealing with as he wrote a very candid letter to a church, a letter which we now call the Book of Romans. Paul had never been to this church, which was located in the ancient capital city of Rome. But he was probably hoping that if he wrote this letter and talked about what he believed Christianity was, they would help him financially to support him as he traveled throughout the Roman Empire, starting churches and telling people about Jesus. In order to get their support, Paul writes this extensive letter explaining his understanding of Jesus' message and how he thought that God had acted through Jesus to deal effectively with the problem of sin. Paul says that when Adam and Eve disobeyed God in the Garden of Eden, all the way back to the book of Genesis, by eating the fruit that God had told them not to eat, that act of disobedience caused a huge rift between God and humanity. In that story, God tells Adam and Eve that the consequences of their choice is that they will eventually get sick and die. That's the consequence for eating that fruit. Paul says that those consequences still live on, that those consequences of sickness and death were passed on to Adam and Eve's children, and then to their grandchildren, and to their grandchildren, and so on. That's why people get sick and die, Paul says. That's what he means when he says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death." In the Old Testament, God dealt with the problem of sin by providing the people of Israel with this very long list of laws that they had to follow. As long as they followed those laws, God would bless them in their lives. They would prosper and have lots of kids. If they didn't, they would suffer the consequences of breaking God's laws. But the problem is that God hadn't dealt with the problem of death. People who obeyed God's laws, they still got sick and they still died like everybody else. Paul associates our bodies with sin. He says our bodies have this inborn tendency to want to do what we know is wrong. The tendency is related to Adam and Eve's choice to disobey God. Because they chose to disobey God, now we all want to disobey God. Because their sin led to death, so now we find ourselves wanting to do the wrong thing, and the wages of our sin is death. I know it sounds kind of unfair to all of us. Why should we be blamed for what Adam and Eve did? Why should we suffer the consequences for what they did? It wasn't our choice. Well, you have to keep in mind that Paul is trying to help people make sense out of the fact that when you look around at the people around you, everyone seems to want to do the wrong thing. Except if there's some kind of outside influence that teaches them or forces them to do what's right. Our kids don't grow up knowing how to do what's right or even wanting to do what's right. They have to be taught right from wrong. And we all know one child or another whose parents really didn't bother to teach him or her right from wrong. And when they don't do that, it doesn't turn out well. In fact, we adults seem to be much the same way. Even if we've been taught right from wrong, we still want to do what's wrong unless we've got some overarching reason to do what's right. When I was on vacation, I happened to catch a TV show that Michelle was watching. It's called Mystery Diners. The host, Charlie Stiles, is like a consultant who just happens to have a TV show, restaurant consultant. Restaurant owners who seem to be having some kind of trouble with the restaurants will call him up. Maybe somebody is stealing from them or the employees are creating some kind of misconduct. And he helps them investigate what's going on with the restaurant while the employees are not looking. In a show that I saw, the owner of a health food restaurant in Las Vegas called him up about the fact that there was protein powder that kept on going missing. And so he set up hidden cameras all over the restaurant. He even had an undercover actress come in and pose as a new employee that they were supposed to train. As the investigation unfolded, he found that the store's manager was using his position to offer personal training sessions. And he was selling the protein powder for cash. Of course, the manager was pocketing the cash. But he was trying to compensate for the missing powder by instructing the other employees to only use half of the powder they were supposed to use when they made protein drinks for their customers. Now remember, the owner is sitting outside the restaurant in a truck watching all of this go on a TV screen. She was just fuming as she watched this employee steal from her restaurant. Now this kind of thing goes on in one episode after another. And it isn't just employees either. Some business owners and managers and CEOs also cheat their employees. It goes on in all aspects of life. Paul says that this tendency towards doing what's wrong is inborn. It's in our bodies as human beings. He owns up to it himself. He says that even though he is Jesus' follower, even though he has dedicated his life to serving God, he is like he just used to be in some respects. He constantly finds himself doing the exact opposite of what he knows he's supposed to do. And he can't bring himself to do what's right. He doesn't want to do what's right. He describes himself as a slave to sin. And this is Paul, the apostle, the guy who went and started a bunch of churches. This is Paul saying this. He serves this desired sin as though it were his master. How many of you can relate to that? I know I can. I find myself wanting to do all kinds of terrible things. The desire to do those things never really goes away, no matter how strong your faith is. So how are we different from anybody else if we're people of faith? Isn't being a Christian supposed to help you do what's right? Paul rightly tells people that the key is having the right mindset. And for Paul, that right mindset begins when we as believers allow God's Spirit to fill our minds and guide us towards what is right. Look what he says in verse 25. He says, "With my mind I am a slave to the law of God, but with my flesh I am a slave to the law of sin." It's kind of like I said last week. If you don't believe that God gives you any help in doing what's right, then you really are out there flapping the wind, keeping life together solely by whatever self-discipline you can or cannot muster in life. We all know folks like that. All they have is whatever little self-control they seem to be able to conjure up at any given moment. And as a result, they're honestly out of control. Their lives appear to be at the mercy of some destructive force outside of them. And it isn't going so well. They're holding on for dear life, and sometimes that isn't enough. Their lives bear the scars of one tragedy after another of their own making. But the good news is that God does not leave us out there flapping in the breeze. I wouldn't be here if I wasn't convinced that God has given us a chance to have power over those desires. Paul says to us, hey, when you have faith in Jesus, his Spirit fills your mind and guides you towards what is right. You will still want to do the wrong thing. You will still have dark thoughts. The temptations will not stop. Anyone who says that their faith has kept them from even being tempted to doing wrong is fooling themselves. But through God's power, you can still stare down your own personal demons and do the right thing, even when you think you can't. Even when every fiber in your body tells you that you're going to give in. Even when a lot of people you know have given in. Even when you question what you were taught in terms of right and wrong. God's Spirit works in our minds. It heals the wounds of our childhoods. It fills in the moral gaps, the situations that people never prepared us to deal with. It makes us stronger because we've given ourselves credit for it. Because of your faith, because of God's Spirit, you are stronger than you know. You need to remember that because you will face situations when you think you are already defeated. You'll find yourself in a spot, maybe a similar situation, and this little voice inside your head is going to say, you know you're going to give in. You can't do what's right. You've never been able to do what's right. Don't even bother trying. But those of us who have God's Spirit are more than conquerors. Greater is He that is within us, the Bible says. We don't need to feel powerless over our own lives. We can do what's right. We can stay away from the things we know we shouldn't do. We can stare down the personal demons that have haunted us. And it's never too late, never too late in life to take back control through the power of God's Spirit. Back in 2000, the movie A Beautiful Mind told the story of Princeton University professor John Nash. Nash is a brilliant mathematician who is secretly recruited by the Defense Department to help them break coded messages regarding an enemy plot. He also enjoys the friendship of his former college roommate, who is also back on campus to teach. His roommate's adorable young niece also becomes a good friend during his time at Princeton. Defense Department Agent William Parcher, this very mysterious character, appears secretly to Nash and takes him to a secret facility where he was given what he needs to begin working on cracking the code. Much to the surprise of the other cryptologists working for the department, Nash is able to break the code and decipher the messages. The Parcher then gives Nash a new assignment to look for coded messages in magazines, newspapers regarding another Soviet plot. But Nash becomes increasingly paranoid, worrying that there's somebody out to get him. His behavior becomes increasingly erratic in the coming months, prompting his wife to call a local psychiatric hospital. One day while he is lecturing at Harvard University, Nash looks into the crowd and he believes that people are there to harm him. He runs out of the room right in the middle of his lecture, but he's chased and eventually is arrested by people who he considers to be Soviet agents. When he comes to consciousness, he is confronted by a number of facts which seem to contradict everything he thought he knew about working for the Defense Department. The truth is that neither his roommate, nor the niece, nor Agent Parcher exist at all. He is shocked to find that he suffers from schizophrenia. These people whom he knew so well are actually figments of his imagination. He goes through shock treatment and he takes medicines. He struggles with the side effects. The situation takes a toll on his marriage. He has relapses. It's an incredibly difficult situation. You feel as though he's not really going to win this battle himself. But in one poignant scene, he comes to the realization that these people he sees are never really going to go away. His best chance of dealing with them is to mentally dismiss them from his life. He tells them this. He shakes his roommate's hand. He bends down to give the niece a kiss goodbye. And mentally walks away from them. He ignores Agent Parcher's threats as he moves on with his life. They will always be there in his life to some extent. But he claimed a level of power over them. The power to say, you're not going to destroy my life anymore. I'm not going to give you any more influence over my decision. That's the kind of power we have available to us through God's Spirit. The Holy Spirit not only guides us towards what is right, but also empowers us to do it. It does not remove the ancient Parchers from our lives. They will still be there. They don't have to win. They don't have to run things. They don't have to pin us down in our own lives. Paul goes on in chapter 8 and says that the law of the Spirit of life in Christ has set you free from the law of sin and death. God has done what we couldn't do so that we could begin doing what we should. As Paul says, we also say today, Thanks be to God through Christ our Lord. So go today in freedom through the power of God's Spirit. Let it guide you. Let it focus you. Let it discipline you. But may it also free you from sin so that you may enjoy your life. Let us pray.